Good afternoon, everyone, and thank you for joining us today. My name is Tracy Nyer, and I'm with the Virginia Small Business Development Center, or the Virginia SBDC. For those of you who are not familiar, the Virginia SBDC is a partnership with the U.S. Small Business Administration, George Mason University, and local hosts throughout Virginia. We provide customized counseling and education for small businesses in Virginia. Most of our services are offered locally in our 27 locations throughout the Commonwealth. Today's webinar, Innovation During COVID-19, is one of our educational offerings meant to help small businesses think about how to innovate with limited resources in a time like this. Today's webinar is being delivered by Floor Blindenbach-Driessen. Floor founded Organizing for Innovation after watching many innovative ideas that never made it to practice. Organizing for Innovation helps established organizations create new revenue streams through innovation and new business development so they can make a difference for their client in the world. She's assisted innovators in their innovative efforts in both large and small firms, as well as supporting startups in entrepreneur programs like the Virginia SBDC's ICAP program. Before we get started, a couple of housekeeping items. We're recording today's presentation, and it, as well as the slides, will be available on our website under Webinars and Recordings. If you have any questions during the presentation, type those in the Q&A window, and Floor will do her best to answer them at the end of the presentation. Without further ado, here's Floor.
Well, thank you, Tracy. Let me see if I can move the slides down. Yes. Okay. Well, thank you for that introduction. Tracy is the operation manager at the Virginia SBDC. She put all of this together, and I'm really grateful for that. And I will do my best to deliver today a very interactive presentation. So expect to get to work. A bit about me. Tracy made already an introduction, and on LinkedIn, you can find all the official details about me, and there's only one Floor Blindenbach-Driessen on this planet. That's the only advantage of having a terrible name like this. So a few fun facts. I think from the whole audience that's today online, I probably am the only one who was really disappointed that the Americans won the World Cup this summer because they beat the Dutch. So if you are a soccer fan, and this is also to see if we can get everyone online and participate in the Q&A. If you are a soccer fan, put it in the Q&A and state that you're a soccer fan, because I would love to know who of you are all soccer fans. The other perhaps fun fact about me, I am Dutch, and I moved about across the Atlantic about 5 times. The first time when I was 16 as a Rotary exchange student, and I had the pleasure of living in Mount Vernon, Illinois. So I would invite anyone who is on the broadcast today, for the participants, if you have lived abroad, let us know. And then last but not least, I'm not a very good cook, to be honest. So in the current time, my kids have taken it upon them to cook themselves. I love experimenting with food, so I'd love to make new stuff. But it doesn't always turn out that well. And I'm not really good at following recipes because I always think, oh, I can skip over something. So if you love cooking, again, like, please feel free to share. And as I said, like, I want this to be interactive. So get the Q&A going and participate. That is more than enough about me. So let's focus on where this coming hour is about. The objective is how to innovate as a small company with limited resources in a crisis time. And I see that I may need to move this a bit to the side. The topics I would like to address are the necessities and the benefits of innovating during a crisis, who to put to the task, how to define new opportunities, how to obtain buy-in, how to test with a limited budget, and how to take it from there in these uncertain times. That's a lot of topics in the coming hour, and so let's bite them off one by one. As Tracy mentioned, there are like a lot of people online at the moment, and therefore, like, with the questions and Q&A, it may be a little bit of tricky. I will try to answer as many questions as possible at the end of this webinar, but feel free to shoot me an email and I will promise you I'll answer that. Or if you have like a specific question about the specific situation, please feel free to email me and I'll get back to you after this webinar. And my email address is here on the screen, fblinden@organizingforinnovation.com with a numeric 4. So why should you think about innovating at all? An innovation or any like unexpected event that happens like this, we go as humans through several motions. So the first thing you need to do is to resolve. That is like, figuring out what is this crisis about? How are you going to cope with it? Realize what happened and what are the implications? Then the second phase is resilience. We start working from home. You get webinars up. If you need to visit your doctor, a telemedicine visit, you do all kinds of new stuff to deal with your new environment. That's probably where we are right now. And where I would like to focus today is on step 3, return, reimagination, and reform. Because given what happened, it's very unlikely that the future will be the same as it was before the coronavirus crisis happened. So what are the implications for your business? Can we reimagine that? And then can we perhaps reform what we did in the past and take advantage of this new world that's going to be? Research into the crisis of 2008, the banking crisis, showed that a few companies came really roaring out of that crisis. And there were like just 9% of the companies, and they outperformed their rivals by at least 10%. And the difference is that they focused on operational efficiency and invested in innovation. So they did not fire all their employees or really cut down costs. They did not go overboard in innovation either. They did a mixture of both. And leading to the crisis of McKinsey, that's more like anecdotal evidence. And that's also how I will build up today's webinar. I will use a lot of research that's out there to build the foundations, but I'll also give you a lot of practical examples of how this works in practice. So they found that your job isn't to know the unknowable, but the first to know and the fastest to act. And another thing, we will be sharing the slides, and all these green highlights are references, so you know where to look for this information afterwards. So what does this mean? An example is maybe interesting. The ADSL market, which stands for, and I need to look it up, asymmetric digital subscriptions lines. And that started in 1979. You had Geoffrey, who figured out that over a copper wire, you could transfer much more than just a phone call. You could also transfer data. So a lot of companies jumped on it, amongst others Siemens, Ericsson, and Alcatel. And they looked into and what the applications could be of that new technology and these new possibilities. Their focus was on video on demand. And we're talking here about the 80s. So it was a fantastic idea, but people were still using video recorders and internet didn't exist yet. So basically that was a bust. And only in 1993, a new protocol came out for the internet. And that's where this ADSL technology found its use. So you had these companies, Ericsson, Siemens, and Alcatel. There were a few others as well. Who suddenly had to shift the focus of where they were going. It was no longer video on demand, but it was this new thing, the internet. And I would like you to use the Q&A to identify who do you think won this race? Siemens, who had twice as many patents as anyone else. They had about 600 patents, where the next company had just 300 or less. Was it Ericsson, who was the first to kind of explore the ADSL market and had been longest in it? Or was it Alcatel, who had the whole supply chain to kind of adjust to this new broadband reality? So if you can use the Q&A, and I hope I can pull it up underneath here. Oh, pitch up. Q&A. So what do you think? Can you, for the answers, like, do you think it was Siemens with most patents that won, Ericsson, who had been longest in this market of the, in the technology, or Alcatel? Who do you think conquered the ADSL market and the ADSL port in the internet time? Ah, someone perhaps know the... It's awesome that you all are participating. That's what I'd love to see. So I get some votes for Alcatel, Ericsson, Siemens, all over the map. Well, I can reveal you the answer. The answer is Alcatel. I'll bring this down again. Because as we can see, because they were the fastest to act, because they had the supply chain, they could really quickly shift and change their whole organization and build an organization around this new broadband technology. So again, it's the first to know and the first to act. That's the one that wins. And that's what I would like you to be able to do as well. So how can you be the first to know and how can you be the first to act? Let's work on that. And let's start with who to put to the task, because you need people to explore new ideas. For that, it will be helpful to know that knowledge, skill, and passion are equally important for the success and of an innovation project. And not every team member needs to have all these attributes. And in a time like this, I can imagine that your most knowledgeable and most skilled people, you already need to put to task to just keep your operations afloat. So there may be people that are very passionate about certain areas, or that you can instill a passion in to make it work. And just to give you a practical example, what we did when I worked at Children's National, for instance, for the summer, we had the opportunity to explore crowdfunding. And in that time, like, crowdfunding was really, really new. Kickstarter just had started. It was less than a year old. But we were wondering if we could use that to see if that could be a nice funding mechanism for our researchers to broadcast their pediatric surgical research projects. None of us had time for it, but we had summer students, and some of them were really passionate about crowdfunding and engaging the community in general. So we used these students to basically run with this project, and they really pulled it off. And I'll come back to this example of this crowdfunding a couple of times later as well. So it was, these students were selected not because they had the knowledge or skills about crowdfunding or customer engagement, but because they were very passionate and they pulled it off. So what I would like you to do, and as I said, like, I want this to be an interactive session. In your organization, if you look around to who is available, who is totally overwhelmed with kind of keeping things running as they are, and who may have some time because their job has changed so much or there is no longer a need for it. So if you can take a minute to write down 2 to 5 names in your organizations, or perhaps summer students, or who could you put to the task? And as you can see, I put a timer on here below. So just take a minute to write down 2 to 5 names in your organization, or who you could put to the task, or who could help you out in exploring new opportunities. I think of a few passionate, talented people. Okay, awesome. And we'll build up from here. So the next task, and we now are already at three, and I need to look at the timing, but I think we're doing just fine timing-wise. So the third point on our agenda item, how to define new opportunities. And that's a matter of where to look. Where do you look for new stuff? And I can't stress enough, it needs to be something different. Because if you keep doing what you already did and expect different outcomes, it's not going to happen. I believe that's someone defined it as the definition of insanity, expecting something different while keep doing the same. So where to look? You can ask your current customers, what are they struggling with? How do they see the future? What is changing for them? Or you can look at non-customers. And here I have one team that was led by Joyce Boehmer, and their company was called Scalia, and it's a paper distributor. And I'm not kidding, if you have seen like the Netflix series The Office, that's what they did. They distributed paper. So it was clear that they would be running out of business sooner or later. They asked their current customers, what did their current customers say to them, what they were looking for in the future? They wanted more and different qualities of paper. Basically the same what they were already doing. As a student of mine, I then asked her and said like, well, can you also interview for me like 10 non-customers? What are they saying? Why are they not buying from you? And that provided to be much more useful, because these non-customers told her and said like, well, we buy our paper in bulk and we buy it together with our cleaning supplies, our toilet paper, all the big bulky items. That's how we buy our paper. So they learned as an organization, if they wanted to keep in the business they were at, they needed to create like an entire and holistic approach and offer the whole set of supplies and not just paper. So that's what can be informative by not only looking at your current customers, but also asking your non-customers. Webinars like this one, but there are plenty other webinars out there, especially at the moment. And not only go to the webinars that are in your industry or really focused for you. I have had the opportunity to go to like legal tech conferences, but even to also to healthcare conferences, because we work with a lot of professional service providers. And it's been fascinating for me to see like totally different communities talk about similar problems in a very different way, often very eye-opening. But behind your computer and a webinar, you don't even have to travel to kind of like pick up how others talk about an issue that concerns you or where you see an opportunity. Now you have the trends. Gartner and Forrester are companies that put out like trend forecasts with all the newest technologies and where they see the world going. A bit of a disadvantage of those kind of like general reports, of which the highlights are typically available for free, is that everyone sees them. And so you're kind of like running behind what's out there, but still it can be inspirational. And then your employees. Yesterday, I had the pleasure to be in a Miro online brainstorming session. That's a very nice and fancy tool. Again, like I have the link there if you want to try it out. It's also a free tool. So you can use even in these time, like your employees, and put sticky notes on a virtual wall and like look for ideas together. And if you have like a diverse talent pool in terms of like young and old, male, female, from different disciplines, from different perhaps backgrounds, areas, engage every one of them, because the goal is really to look as broadly as possible to all the opportunities that are out there. And with that being said, and me having talked so much, I would encourage you to take a minute and write down at least one thing that you're going to undertake to proactively find new opportunities. And I would love for you to share those again in the Q&A, because I think what you're gonna explore may be very inspirational for someone else as well. So write it down for yourself and feel free to also share it with our group. And I'll put again the timer on for a minute here at the bottom, and I'll open the Q&A. If you can share Love to get to know you better, Michael. Reach out to non-customers. Awesome. Awesome, Pamela. Thank you for sharing. And I see that my timer stopped if I do this. That's strange. You're getting some nice examples. Anyone else? For like specific conference or willing to take on like a tool like Miro? Oh, I need to see that. Awesome. Thank you. Okay. Well, thank you so much for sharing all that you're going to do. That's awesome. Fine. Great. I'm going to put this away for a sec. So now that we have some inspiration, what to do next? Cool. The next one we need to work on is obtain buy-in. And this works two ways, bottom up and top down. Because if you have like a new or, and assume it can be crazy enough, but if you have a new idea, how do you get, if you are like an employee in an organization, how do you get your convince your boss? Or if you are like the CEO of the organization, how do you get your organization along? So that's what I would like to focus on in this section. Let's start with the employee. And for that, I have a little story about Denise. And she worked as an admin for a law firm. But at the same time, she was following an IT. She was trying to become like an IT professional and was following IT classes at Nova, the community college here in Northern Virginia. And she was getting bored and out of her mind by all the repetitive tasks she had to do. She made errors, she was frustrated. And she was like, one weekend, she was like, you know, if I apply what I've learned to the job I'm doing, I can do this like overnight. Why are we, there is a better way to do this. So she spent the next 3 weekends in finding a solution. And after 3 weeks and a lot of evenings of hard work, she went to her boss full excitement and was like, hey, I have gotten a better solution to explore and synchronize these databases. And it's cheaper, it's faster, and it's error-free. Can you imagine what her boss told her? He looked at her with a blank gaze and said, can you please go back to work? He didn't even ask what the solution was about. And so very disappointed, Denise went back to work. So what went wrong here? Was the idea she had stupid? Not at all. The problem was that her boss was just not aware and not aligned. Like Denise was so far ahead of the troops that she just did not bring him along. So in this graph that you see here, we have here the decision progress and here we have the problem solution knowledge. So if you plot it here, is that Denise was somewhere up here. She was very aware of the problem and wanted her organization to make the decision, but that was not her decision to make. So probably. Her boss, however, was totally not aware that this was a problem because this was something Denise had to deal with day to day. But as a lawyer, he didn't see any of that, any of those administrative tasks. And he was not willing to make a decision at all. So this is where Denise introduced her new idea, and it didn't go anywhere. So what she should have done is first make her boss aware of the problem. Tell him, for instance, like, do you know that in the reports we made last week, there were 6 errors? And from that, she can say, like, do you know that some of our competitors or some other firms have automated some of these tasks? And so slowly you move your organization or your boss or your division up in this awareness stream to where they see and recognize, like, there is a problem, and that they're, and with the awareness that this is a problem that needs addressing, the decision-making willingness also increases. So this is from the side, like, if you are like an employee and need to convince your boss, like, this is a good idea to do something new. What happens on the other end? Because I've been on both ends and I've seen both ends happen. So you have a very enthusiastic Denise that comes to you with an idea, and you think, oh my dear, what do I do with this? How do I, I think this is never gonna work, and this is a waste of time, as Denise's boss did in the beginning. I urge you, please listen, because I've seen many innovators and very talented employees leave companies because bosses were not willing to listen to their new ideas. But that does not mean that you need to accept everything. So for instance, in this case with Denise, if you disagree with what she is proposing, give her a challenge. Challenge her on the assumptions she's making. The assumption she made was that there were a lot of errors in the work she did, and that those errors were costly. So it wouldn't have costed this boss a lot of money to ask, so can you define for me how many errors we make on a weekly or monthly basis, and what are the associated costs? And that way you both have factual data, and then you can have a decision for discussion. Do we as an organization need to do something about this, or are we going to leave it as is? And again, I can't stress it enough. If you just say, like, it doesn't feel right, I, as an innovator, I can do anything with that information. I can challenge you, you're the boss, and that's how you lose your talented employees. So please, if you disagree or if you don't think it's the right direction, give them a task that will prove themselves wrong. And I've, again, like, from research, we know that people that got the opportunity to explore something, they will come back with better ideas and more often. This is kind of like a side note. Then how to obtain buy-in top down? Well, that basically is change management. And in this whole webinar, I have about 2 minutes to introduce you to the topic, which is clearly not enough, but I can give you like a bit of a high level overview of a few tips and tricks that will help to get people along. The Power of Why is a very interesting TED talk by Simon Sinek that I absolutely can recommend. And one of the examples he creates, what he suggests is you do, like, if you want to make change happen, you need to create a following. And you don't create a following by explaining what and focusing on how, but by getting people behind the why. And the example he gives is about Martin Luther King. If Martin Luther King would have tried to rally the troops about the Civil Rights Act, he probably would not have gotten anyone to rally for him. You would say, like, hey, Floor, you don't know the US history? Yes, I know he changed it. And I know due to his work that was installed. But if you have people focus on the solution, you get endless debates on what the solution should look like. So he did not rally the troops around the Civil Rights Act. He rallied the troops and was able to get everyone united behind the idea if that all men are created equal. All men are created equal. That was the why. That was why people flocked to him. And then the Civil Liberty Act, that was the solution. And there was a lot of fussing about the details. And that's why it's much more difficult to get people behind a solution than behind an aspiration. Then don't tell teams what to do. Instead, specify the problem or opportunity that you would like to see addressed. That Kickstarter team I mentioned in the beginning, What do you think is the better way to kind of like get the broadest idea out there? If I would have told them, A, I need you to look into new funding opportunities for our research teams, so look into new funding opportunities, or B, I would like you to explore crowdfunding as a possible alternative funding mechanism, or C, I want you to use Kickstarter and set up an fundraising campaign for one of our research projects. So again, we can use the Q&A. Just, what do you think works best? The very generic, A, the generic question, like what is an alternative funding solution for our research teams? B, investigate crowdfunding as an opportunity, or C, use Kickstarter? Ah, okay. There seems to be consensus about A. Indeed, A gets you a much broader, like if you would just ask this students to look into alternative research opportunities, they probably would have found us a lot of new different and original mechanisms. So I absolutely agree with anyone who put in A, that is how you get the broadest and most novel opportunities to go after. However, in this case, we wanted to be pretty specific, and these students did not have that much time. They only had a summer, and we knew that crowdfunding was the next new thing. So we decided to give them the challenge of crowdfunding. We didn't specify what platform they needed to use or how they were going to set it up or how they were going to run the experiments. The students ran with that, but we did narrow it a bit further down because we didn't want them to explore the entire world. We didn't think they did have the skill set either to explore that broadly. So we kind of kept it in the middle. But that's for something for you to also kind of like decide, like how specific do you want to instruct the team? But the more open you keep it, the wider, the more you give the opportunity to the team to make the best out of it. Sorry, Anne. I was clicking through the slides, my too many buttons. If you are a small organization, have one team work on one project at a time. Because if you do two projects at the same time, it will take twice as long to get these projects finished. So it works much better to do the project sequentially, explore an opportunity, do it quickly, and then work on the next opportunity than to explore two opportunities in parallel, because it just will take you too long to see what works best. I also would strongly suggest that you make it very clear that each early stage project is an option. Nothing is set in stone till you really have defined, like, with pretty certainty that this is a project you want to explore and then have de-risked it far enough that's worth all the investments. So really see all these early stage opportunities and all this testing that goes on in the early phases as an option to explore. Here, so we can see. another thing is ask teams to explicate and test the critical assumptions they are making. This is a statement that's very generic, and I'll get back to it multiple times in the coming half an hour. So, and stick to the facts. As I mentioned before, there's not much room for gut feeling. So, I would like you again to use the Q&A, and this time take a minute to write down what actions are you going to take to obtain buy-in for your idea. If it's whether it's bottom-up or top-down, like how are you going to create awareness, or as leadership, how are you going to listen to these employees that you set out to, or a team that you set out, or top-down? How do you start with the why and test your assumptions? timer goes. And please feel free to share again in the Q&A because it can inspire others. And sure. That's a great idea. Focus on the problem. Yes. You never can explain a problem clear enough. So. Awesome. Great awareness. Yeah. I'm scrolling down. Okay, some great suggestions. And I think the most important takeaway here from is it takes active effort to get that buy-in. So let's move on to the next topic. How to test with a limited budget. I'm looking at the time as well. We are doing great timing-wise. What to test? I mentioned before, assumptions. Not just an assumption, the most critical assumption. What assumption is that? That's the assumption that will prove your entire project wrong. If I tell it like this, it seems so obvious, of course. But that's not how we are trained or how we usually function. Normally, if we enter a debate or if you want to convince something, we use all the things that prove that we are right. But if you're testing assumptions, we ask you very specifically to look at the things to prove yourself wrong. And that's, again, like, let's do a little exercise to show how that works, because it's easy to say, but so difficult to do in practice. The example is of one of my other participants in one of my programs. They wanted to make a diabetes kiosk. And their idea was to create an electronic portal that is located in an easy accessible place, and ever thinking about like libraries or pharmacies, where patients and caregivers could find like reliable information about their diabetes treatment and health. That was their idea. So can you again share in the comments, what is the most critical assumption this team should test first? So if you were this team, or what is the assumption you would ask them to test? Like, what is for them the most critical assumption? Can we put that in the Q&A again? I'll get my this going. Give you a minute. Get the timer. Whether there will be demand for such a service? Yeah, Claire, can you specify it more specifically? Patient actually interested in finding info? Yeah. Are they an authority in the field? Yeah, that's in. Want to utilize this clinic? Yeah. Thank you for clarifying, Claire. You're pretty good at all at this. We got some great suggestions in how you could test this out. So the most critical assumption is indeed, like, is there a need for reliable information about diabetes in an easy accessible public place? A lot of you alluded to that as well. Like, is there even a need for such a portal? Because if it's not, then this whole project is not needed. And just know, like, as a team, they were working, their main discussions were about like what needs to be on that portal, how are we going to make the decision tree go, which like software should we use? But this is the most critical discussion, the whole basis of their project that they needed to test first. I'll get back to this example later, like how do you then set up such a test? But let's first like give you some options. So how do you test with a limited budget? Again, interview customers, current customers, non-customers works really great. Mockups, that's usually used in IT. I had a Mona Lisa team. They created mockups for their application, worked perfectly fine. I went with them to clients and asked like, what would you use this for? And they had like, they pulled together communications in crisis situations, like if you get like a bad Twitter or tweet about your company, like how do you respond? So they use mockups to verify that. And a third way to kind of test it is a minimum viable product. And again, I've provided a link here for if you want to get more information what a minimum viable product is, because it is also one of these concepts that is very easy to explain, but in practice is not always that easy. So I would like to use the Dutch day after example to explain that one. Let me get my notes here then. This was a Dutch team of mine, and they focused on recreational drug users, and just in the Netherlands, drugs is legal. And they found that those users go to music festivals, but the day thereafter, when they have to go back to work, they have a terrible hangover. I can tell you this is not my scene, and it's not what I approve of, but that is not up to me to decide. Like, people come with me with all kinds of questions, and I'm here to help them think critically and can they bring their idea to practice. So this was a pharmacist that was working on this project, and she was really active and went to all these music festivals. And she was wondering and asked me like, so how do I create like this potion, so to speak, that would stop this hangover? And said like, I know, like I use quite a few medicines myself, but I would mix that and in a new pill, I would need to get like FDA approval or at least a European equivalent. I can't really patent it because it's a mixture. It's not something new. She was way down in the weeds. So I said to her, I said like, okay, how can we test this with a minimum viable product? What does that mean? I said like, so what are the pills you take? She said, well, that's quite a few. We're 22 pills. I said like, if we can make these 22 pills, and she explained to me how she did it. Like, she took a few 2 days before, a few 1 day before, a few of the day of the festival, and then a few the day thereafter. I said, if you just make 4 containers, put all these pills in there, label them, and if you would sell those on Facebook to your friends that you go to the festival with. And because she was a pharmacist, you could sell it. I said, like, I can try. I think 22 pills is a lot. I said, two, through. But at least you can see if there's a need for such a solution. Lo and behold, she got 20 customers. 20 people purchased these 4 containers from her. She shipped them out with the labels in them, made a cutesy looking pot, and asked them to give them a reply afterwards. Of the 20, 12 never used it. And why not? They realized the 22 pills they had to swallow seemed like a lot to them. And they decided to forgo all the party drugs altogether. They were like, well, you know, this is really bad for me. So they were out. 8 did use it. And they said, 2 said like 22 pills is a lot. But that made her realize if she would reduce that to 4 pills, she probably would stimulate drug use. And with that, she canceled her entire project. But that's what we call a minimum viable project, where you create a minimum viable version of a working solution that kind of mimics and can help you test whether there's a real true demand. So back to our kiosk. How can we test for this kiosk with a minimum viable type of version, what that should look like? What could be here a minimum viable product for this electronic portable that would help us test the solution if there is a need for reliable information about diabetes in an easy accessible public place. I'm going to do the same thing here. Ah, yes, Eric Ries, the Lean Startup. I have references to his work in this slide deck. So thank you for recommending that. And health fair, mock it up on a tablet. Social media survey. Any more suggestions? I see a lot of surveys. For a survey, it's sometimes difficult because with a survey, it's again like you ask what you want to hear. So it's more confirmation of what you already know. So we try to stay away from surveys. Ask a doctor, yeah. Support groups. Okay, let's see what we have. Survey people coming into the library. Well, I think as a group, you're doing awesome because indeed, what we did, what I asked them to do is create, literally, and that's why I put this icon there, a diabetes info cardboard sign. They were health students, so they could provide diabetes info. They went to a library, and on a Saturday morning, they sat on a table with their little sign and just looked who came. And they learned that patients, they only had one or two diabetes patients come to them and ask, like, what's this about? And they really didn't need the information because they had support groups. They also learned that the ones that really came to them were the caregivers. For them, it was much more important because they've got a huge argument about treatments. But what they needed was not just diabetes info on treatment, but very specific on the person they were caring for. Would they need to do A or B? And for that, they realized we need to integrate the medical information, which makes it impossible to put it at a public place. So this little experiment completely changed their whole outlook of the problem they wanted to solve and how they want to solve it. But it was just with a cardboard sign for an electronic solution. So really look for simple, cheap solutions. Just looking how we're doing on time. We're doing great. And that brings me to another aspect. Is how to test with a limited budget, the last one. Yes, sometimes you need funding or time as in this kiosk case. Typically when we think about innovation, we think about an investment in the future. So return on investment is important. You want to create a return on that investment because otherwise you better put money in the bank or invest it in another opportunity. However, calculating a return on investment from an innovation activity is really difficult, especially for these very early stage things. With a spreadsheet, I can make any number or any return work look awesome. So at these early stages, I strongly suggest you look at affordable loss. What can you stand to afford to lose? And I'll get back to that crowdfunding platform. Again, this was in 2010, when making a website was pretty expensive. As Children's National decided, it was worth investing 20K and having these students spend their entire summer on this project to see if it was feasible. So we built a website, we got five projects on there, and we launched the whole thing together with the foundation. We got funding in that paid for more than the project, but we didn't get as much funding as we would like. If we hadn't run that experiment, we would not have known that at that time, our researchers in the Institute were just not social media savvy enough to pull something like that off. Very few had more than 500 people in their networks. We were, just as an organization, absolutely not ready. Again, that was a valuable lesson. It was worth to the organization $20,000. They decided that up front. So instead, here too, like, as a small organization, if you have to weigh where to spend your money, think about, like, how much would it cost us to explore that opportunity just one step further, that we would feel more comfortable in making a bigger investment, and how much is that worth us to us? Is that, can we afford to lose a Saturday morning, $1,000 to set something up, or whatever you need to pull that off? That is what we mean with an affordable loss principle. And again, you can find more on that with all these links. Which brings me to, and sorry for Tracy for moving you around the screen, how to take it from there in these uncertain times. Expect change to happen. So even if you have detailed out all your project details, and you're diligent about your assumption testing, things will change. And that's why it's so important to have to explicate all the assumptions you're making, put them on the wall, and keep them up there. We do the same. Like, currently, we don't know when things will reopen again, which will impact our business. So we put that on, I have that big on my board in my study, because it's an important date. And if it changes, it will impact how we operate. Use the affordable loss principle to explore. What can you afford to lose? And what will you win in insights and knowledge? And believe in your strategy. Don't give up too early. And especially remember that, like, in a new market, it's the most adaptable firm that will win. Think about that ADSL example I gave in the beginning. It's the firm that believes in what they're doing and is able to quickest kind of like roll it out. And throughout, try to stick to the facts. There's not much room for gut feel. And given that we are 5 minutes before the end, there's so much more I can tell and elaborate on, but that's kind of like, well, work towards a conclusion. So to summarize, innovating during COVID-19, I hope within this hour you have a few tasks that you can start working on. Your who to put to the task, that you have like at least 2 to 5 passionate employees that you can put to the task. How to define new opportunities, that you have at least one thing that you can explore and have like an idea on how you're going to tackle that. That you know how to obtain buy-in and have like a little bit of a plan of action on how you're going to do that. That you have some idea of how to test with a limited budget, the most critical assumption you're making. And that you know you need to look at the affordable loss principle. And then that you, how to take it from there, that is really a matter of do. Take action. Because if you just dream about it or sit behind your computer, it won't happen. You'll have to take action. You have to stick out your neck. And that's the quote from McKinsey I started with. Because your job isn't to know the unknowable in a crisis like this, but to be the first to know and the fastest to act. And if you act, there are a lot of free online sources. Someone already mentioned the Lean Startup. Strategizer has a nice templates. IDEO is a design firm in California. They also have the IDEO.org. They have a great set of tools, and they have Adobe Kickbox. That's also a useful online tools that can help you. So there's a lot of free resources that can help you if you have an idea to test it and then to bring it further to practice. There are also free programs that can help you, because these online resources, you kind of like, you have to figure out which templates to use and when to use what. The SBDC has the ICAP, the Innovation Commercialization Acceleration Program. They run a virtual cohort, and the deadline to apply ends April 27th. So you can still sign up for that. That program runs in May, and they will help you to kind of define like your customer, the value proposition, and test like your early assumptions and your hypothesis about your new business. We at Organizing for Innovation, we run an online accelerator program for innovation teams in organizations. We have for a special offer for all teams that start before May 1st in our program. You get the first 4 weeks for free. And in those 4 weeks, we'll help you create the project description, get buy-in from your organization, and then help you to make like a business case and a detailed plan of action. So those are just some few resources to kind of get you started from where you are today, which is kind of like a notion after this 1 hour webinar. Because in the end, what we all want is to be successful and get this economy back up roaring. With that, I would like to end it. I will look at the questions. If there are questions, I can stay on perhaps a little longer. I don't know how long we have this webinar slot and exactly what the plans is. So happy to go over a few questions if there are. But if you need to go, feel free and you have a question or you have a specific question, send me an email at fblinden@organizingforinnovation.com. And I'll be happy and gladly to answer any questions that you have.
Wow, thanks, Flor. That was an amazing presentation, both from the content and also from me watching the interaction, because that's not something that you get a lot on webinars. So thank you. We do have a few questions. Can you talk a little bit about the affordable testing and how you can do that during this COVID-19 crisis?
Yes. Affordable testing, there are two concepts that go in between there. One is the affordable loss principle or the testing. I assume for now that you go like, how can you find cheap tests? There are a few crux to that. The first one is to go really at the essence, like what do you need to test? And how do you do that during this COVID-19? And I assume like you can't go out, so you can't set up your kiosk in the library. But at the same time, you have, for instance, you have online Facebook groups for diabetes patients. So you could go out there and ask and engage in conversations. You can reach out to LinkedIn. You can call people. So there's a lot of stuff that you can do currently online, and people are more receptive. So try new ways. We cannot do like face-to-face things, but there are so many other creative ways that you can find solutions. And sometimes it also just helps to ask. So put in such a group, like I would like to do like meet in person, but I can't. How can I reach you? Does that help and clarify?
We'll see if they type back. I don't know. So we've got several questions here about the slides and getting the PowerPoint. We will be posting them on the Virginia SBDC website under the webinars and recordings link, and that's under training. I will also email participants a copy of the slide, anybody that attended today. I will do that. There is one person that asked for them immediately. If you put your email in this question and answer window, I'll make sure that right after the presentation, I get that out.
Okay, and I apologize. I'm here. I'm struggling here keeping, my screen was flashing.
Not a problem. So I think that was the only question that we had was content related. We did have, I'm assuming the May 1 program that you wanted more information about, Tom, was the...
Make a note of your email address, Tom.
We'll make sure that we get that out. Floor mentioned that there is a virtual ICAP program starting. That application and more information on that program can be found at the virginiasbdc.org website under programs. So if you're interested in that, please go read some more on it and put an application in. And I think that is all the questions. So thank you everyone for participating today. And if you keep an eye out for additional webinars that we are offering during this COVID time, we'll both be emailing them out to SBDC clients, as well as posting them in our website. So take care, everyone, and stay safe. Thank you.
Thank you. See you. Bye-bye. Bye.